the block.
All right, welcome to the program, everybody. This is your host, Andy Gervich. Happy Easter. Regardless of your beliefs and your traditions, we are in the spring season, a season of resurrection and transformation. We are hard at work on our spring season for On the Block Radio that's going to begin next week with the Oboe Adi Legacy Project. For this week, we are resurrecting an episode with Renee Mitchell. We hope you enjoy it, and we'll see you next week.
Clearly, I am not a fat ass. I am active brain and lip smacking peach deep, sometimes too aggressive in its honesty, and heart sweet that loves wholly and completely whom it may choose, whomever it may choose. I am not gonna lie and pacify. I am arms to hold. I am lips to speak. I am a motherfucking G. Strong legs that stroll off the 33 bus or out of a money green phantom comfortably. Knees that bend to pray, clean from Ajax washings. Hair that is thick and soft. Thighs that betwixt an amazing all expense grand prize. I am eyes that sing. Smile that brightens, touch that rings, and supplies euphoric release. I am a grand dame queen beast. I am warm, I am peace. From the roads of Botswana, from 23rd Street, from the inside, third eye, ever watching this wicked, wicked system of things I do see. I am friend to pen and a lover of strong women, a diamond to men. I am curious and interested like children. I welcome the wise to teach, appreciator of my culture, thick not just from bone dense and eat. I have a rhythm in my ways and a practice in my seek. And yes, I do crave the rhythm of my space with a man that rejoices in God's grace. With faith, I do hear to listen. Two hands that fist when force pushes to shove and your ego won't submit. And I am gifted. I am all of this, and indeed the shit. Clearly, I am not just an ass.
Recognize what you got between your thighs, come on. Well, so I'm gonna set you right, and I'm starting here tonight. Well, shine like the moon and strong like the sea. Well, more expensive than money, more valuable than anything. Well, juicy mango summer peach. Make a lame man walk and a full man hungry. Well. And if you don't know what I'm saying, then baby, I'm telling you. There's power in them rolling hills. Come on. You're a prized possession. Not everybody's worthy. Only reason I know, 'cause I headed down that road. And it'd be a shame for you not to have your own glow. Come on.
Well,
well. Maybe don't recognize what you got between your eyes. So I'm gonna set you correct so you can get what you should get. Yeah. Intuition, something sweet. Let you know what you know, let you find before you seek.
Spirit of discernment, pray for every day.
Let you know who should go and who you should let stay. And if you don't know what I'm saying, then baby, I'm telling you, yeah, there's power in them rolling hills, come on. I had it on my table. I wanna see you grow. I wanna see you glow. Oh. I wanna see you shine. I mean, all the time. Gotta let that light. Gotta let it shine so bright. Maybe you don't recognize there's power.
Hey everybody, welcome back to the program. Before we get into our announcements and our introduction of the guest for this week, I just want to give a shout out to the opening music from Jilly from Philly. If you are not familiar with the work of Jill Scott, please get yourself over to her website and to iTunes and check out her catalog. I'm late to the game if you haven't noticed. I first became aware of her work with The Roots. And then my wife Celeste introduced me to the rest of her catalog. And you want to talk about somebody who is more than the sum of their parts, who is one of the best singers going, and an actress and an activist and just an all-around consuming presence. She's really an artist worth knowing and worth being invested in. As far as the show goes, we're humming along, ironing out the details. We're on iTunes, SoundCloud, on our website, ontheblockradio.com. I just wanted to let you know that the breaks of the show is formatted, even though it's a podcast, to be something similar to a radio broadcast. And so those of you that have been listening to the show realize this, we have breaks in the middle where we play music, various bits related to the show thematically, clips maybe from our guests for that week, a song or a poem of theirs. What I also intend the breaks to be is for community activism, awareness, and even commercials. And so if you're an author that has a audio clip of your book, or maybe an audio commercial or an audio trailer for your book, or if you would like one produced, contact us and we can help you not only produce that but then get it on the show. If you're a local business, and maybe not even a local business, but especially in the Northwest or the Portland area, and you would like to have an audio commercial or have one produced, or if you have one already to air on the show, if you think your corporate values or the art project you're working on or your music or something is in line with the values of the program, then let us know, because that's what we intend those breaks to be, is to populate those with content from the community, to continue using the show as a platform, as a space for other voices to be heard and for other projects to be magnified. Speaking of that, our guest for this week is S. Renee Mitchell. I'm going to do the formal introduction in the show, but I can tell you that when we started this show, when we had the idea to start the podcast, she was one of the people that we thought, oh man, if we could get Renee on the show, that would really be something else. She's described as a creative revolutionist. She's an art doula. She is a griot. There's just any term you can think of when we think of those people in our community who use their voice not only for empowerment and healing for themselves and their own trauma and their own life experience, but then they sort of, through their productivity and their honesty and just sheer productivity, are templates for the rest of us on how to do something, on how to take the things that are happening to us and in our world and transform them into meaning and purpose. What I love about Renee is that she's a doer. You'll hear in the interview that when she encountered struggle in her career and more importantly in her personal life through a domestic violence situation, she did something about it and not only transformed her personal life, but transformed her career and devoted herself to the transformation of that energy in her own space, and then again for others, over and over again, as we in the conversation come to things, various problems within the culture, various problems within the community, opportunities, holes where things are not being addressed. Renee doesn't just complain about them. Renee doesn't just click like on a Facebook status. Renee doesn't just sign a change.org petition and then go on with her day. She invests herself in a project. She creates, if she sees a need, a children's book to address an issue. If she sees a need, she creates the Portland Youth Poet Laureate Program. If she sees the need, she creates community health and engagement programs to help women of color with domestic violence and other health-related issues. She's a person that really inspires me to do the same thing, and I hope inspires you as well. The world is hurting, and the world requires our doing at the moment, and especially when we address issues of race and social injustice in our society. If we aren't really talking about real dollars, if we aren't investing time and money in the voices and in the communities that have been marginalized for too long, then we're not doing anything, or at least we're not doing enough, because that's really where the rubber meets the road. So that's something I've learned from Renee and others, and it's something I hope comes across clear for you in this episode. We appreciate you being along for the ride, folks, and we'll see you on the other side.
Welcome to On the Block with Andrew Gurvich, a podcast about authentic people doing beautiful things. Enjoy the show.
All right, everyone, welcome to the program. This is your host, Andy Gurvich, and we are sitting today with S. Renee Mitchell. I'll tell you a little bit about your background before we get to speaking with you. Welcome to the show, by the way.
Thank you for having me.
With over 25 years of experience as the most widely read newspaper columnist in the American West, S. Renee Mitchell left a successful career in journalism to pursue a calling as an artist, author, poet, playwright, and community activist. Nominated twice for the prestigious Pulitzer Prize, Renee left an indelible mark on the world of journalism before stepping out into this new phase of her life. She's a celebrated spoken word artist, a painter, an inspirational speaker, a woman's advocate, and an all-around tornado of art, creativity, and activism. Renee has shared the stage with greats such as bell hooks, Danny Glover, pianist Tom Grant, Grammy Award winners Esperanza Spalding and Dr. Thara Memory. I can't wait to ask you about that. And the late singer Linda Hornbuckle. Oh. And many others. She has written a libretto, 7 full plays, a children's book, a novel, 2 books of poetry, and countless articles and short pieces. Renee has been described as a creative revolutionist who explores the issues of gender, race, poverty, art, and identity in her diverse work. She's also been called a creative healing griot who nurtures hope, empowerment, and inspiration. Welcome to the program.
Thank you. That's about half the show there.
Yeah, right? Yeah, thanks for coming, everybody. We'll see you next week. Now, right out of the gate, S. Renee Mitchell. Do I call you Renee? Do I call you Renee. S. Renee's?
Just Renee is fine. Renee I is use fine? The S when it's more of a formal kind of introduction, but yeah.
Okay. Totally. Can I ask what the S stands for?
It stands for secret.
Secret. Nice. That's fascinating. Why?
No, I'm just kidding.
Stands for S.
It actually stands for Sharon.
Okay.
Yes. And when I went away to college, I just started using my middle name because I wanted to just – it was part of me transforming myself, and I've done this a number of times. But when I was growing up, I was just such an insecure, you know, nervous, clumsy, goofy, bullied girl. And I just wanted to create a new persona for myself when I left home to go to away to college. So that's when I became S. Renee.
Became S. Renee.
Yes.
That's amazing. We were speaking before you got here, and I said the only other initial person I could think of was G. Gordon Liddy, and I think you're doing much better work in the world. Than,
Thank you.
So you're redeeming the first initial name thing.
Much appreciated.
So, yeah, I actually wanted to ask you a little bit about your childhood. I read somewhere that you were the middle child
middle
among
child.
Eight. Eight kids and two adopted, right?
Yes.
Wow. Big group.
Very big group. And, you know, a lot of people think because you come from a big family that there was always someone around, and that's certainly very true.
Mm-hmm.
But I felt like I was always very, very unheard and unseen within my family. And some of that was just because, you know, my parents were making a living. They were also very actively engaged in community building.
Mm.
And so they were busy a lot. And so we had so many kids that we were latchkey kids, and it was just very difficult to be heard in that environment.
All the attention goes to the youngest and the oldest. right
exactly. And you know, I don't know, there's probably a lot of middle child listeners out there who kind of understand mm-hmm. where I'm coming from, but you're not the oldest in that group, so, and then you're not the youngest, you're just kind of, you know, trying to find your own place, and which is I think it's really helped me learn how to be independent and also, you know, learn, have the compassion for others who have been in that situation where they felt unheard. So I don't have any regrets about any of that.
You said I read somewhere that you were the tallest child in your family too.
I was the tallest girl.
And absolutely, that's not a good thing for girls to be in a culture that is very that has very thin lines for what a girl is supposed to look like and act like, and tall is not one of them.
And that means big hands and big feet and wide shoulders, mm-hmm. and so it was hard all the way around, because it was not only hard being bullied at home, but also at school for some of those same things.
Wow.
Yes.
Were you creative as a child?
I was, yes. I was always loving art, whether it was drawing or writing, painting. I always lost myself within that. I wasn't necessarily encouraged to do that, but but there was a picture I remember that was taken in the newspaper at a Head Start program.
Mm-hmm.
And I was so intently painting my egg carton. But then, you know, as we grow older, mm-hmm. we forget about those things that we loved so much as children. And I forgot that I loved art so much. And it took, you know, these life experiences and also giving myself permission, which is how I ended up illustrating my children's book.
Wow.
I never thought that I could draw.
I didn't realize you illustrated that yourself. That's wonderful. I have some questions for you about that book, but what you just said reminded me of the, I believe it was the Picasso quote who said, "All children are born artists. The key is staying that way as we grow." And there's a TED talk by a guy named Ken Robinson, English, educational theorist, and he's talking about how education kills creativity in children, and he brings up in that TED, it's a wonderful TED talk, and he brings up this idea that the foundation of education is changing under our feet, not quickly enough, and it should have changed probably 150 years ago, but that children, when we were young, we were given this advice: don't dance, you're not going to be a dancer, don't do art, you're not going to be an artist, like if this activity doesn't create a straight line between, you know, some kind of vocation, then it's a waste of time. And I'm wondering if that was something, you know, that you kind of experienced as a child. And then coming from a large family, I don't know the socioeconomic background, but being a person of color, were you really encouraged, like, don't mess around with any of this stuff, you got to get a job? Or, like, why were you steered away from art?
Well, there were folks in my family who were encouraged to express their creative side. My oldest brother would draw. Mm-hmm. My father was a very good artist before he died when I was 11. And so my brother kind of took over that mantle, so to speak. And he was really encouraged to be the artist.
Oh, okay.
And so it wasn't like we weren't encouraged to do that. It just was I wasn't necessarily encouraged to explore my art.
Okay.
And I didn't even think that I was going to be a writer until after I had gone away to college. That wasn't even my first major, because of the fact that I was, you know, I was really good in the books. I was a very good student. I loved learning and I loved writing. I still have a copy of a story that I wrote when I was about 6 or 7, where the teacher had noted, "Very good story." And my mother saved that. And I still, unfortunately, she was able to save it for me all of these years. And I now have it laminated and look at it, you know, and I thought, wow, that's kind of a really cute story about, you you know, this little girl who was crying and wanted to get on the train. And and so the train conductor said, what are you crying about? Just be quiet and get on the train. And then she rides the train and she's so happy. But, you know, when I look back at there's some real interesting symbolism in there, mm-hmm. that the train conductor said, basically, get over it and just, you know, enjoy your life and stop feeling sorry for yourself.
Wow.
You know, and that lesson has come up again and again. Stop feeling sorry for yourself, because there's going to be things that in your life that are going to make you sad. But it's time to, you know, there's a time for all of that. But you don't wallow in it, and you just move on and enjoy the train ride.
Yeah, that's interesting. I was going to actually just ask you if you, at that young age, when you were just making art and writing a story here and there, were you making the connection, because you said you'd experienced bullying, between art and writing and empowerment and healing, or is that something that came later?
That's totally something that came later.
Okay.
I didn't realize how life-saving that was for me to be able to put those emotional and traumatic things on paper. I never shared that with anyone. I actually would not share the things that I wrote until I was in my 40s.
Really?
Yes, I always thought it was just such a very personal thing.
Yeah.
And it seemed always so sad to me. What I was writing about was always so sad and heartbreaking. It wasn't something I felt very comfortable sharing.
It's a lot of vulnerability to share that with
Absolutely.
People.
Absolutely, yeah. Yes. And so, and I wasn't at that point yet. And so I would continue to write and continue to talk about on paper. I found it very liberating, but I never felt like encouraged to do that. It just felt a natural affection for that kind of way of expressing myself.
Mm. Are you close with your family now?
How to define that?
Yeah, right? Yeah, I don't know. Yeah, that's why I'm asking.
Yeah, we're a year apart. Every one of us,
wow.
We're stair-step children.
Yeah.
That's close.
That's remarkable.
Close in age.
Chronologically close, yes.
I think as adults now, we're really rediscovering each other, because it's hard to break away from those patterns of thought about who that person is. Because you grew up with him, because
right.
you experienced some things with him that you know wasn't always nice,
right?
And so I think it's important as we get older to, you know, allow that person to have grown up a little bit, allow that person to, you know, become who they are as adults. And
yeah.
so I think that we're in the process of kind of learning each other, but there's still is some sense of not really being understood.
Yeah.
And also because now that the things that I've done, you know, in my career, no one really expected it. You know, I was always kind of the ignored child. I do
late
remember
bloomer, the breakout. Yeah.
Yeah. You know, I remember a conversation when I was in high school where there was, you know, my older brothers, and you know, you look up to them just because they're older, and they had some guys around, and so they were talking, you know, having their little teenage guy talk, and they were talking about the girls in the family, and they were talking about who's the prettiest and who's the smartest and who has the most potential. And so, you know, with all of my sisters, you know, every one of their names came up.
Wow.
Except for mine.
No kidding.
Yes.
And you overheard this.
I overheard this.
That had to be painful. Yeah.
It was just, but you know, at the same time I was thinking, I'm going to prove all you guys wrong.
I was just going to ask, have you been motivated in your career to kind of show them that they were wrong about you?
My
them
whole
maybe
life.
Being your family, but them kind of
my
anybody who's
my
said
my whole
that.
Life, you know, because I was always, we grew up in all-white communities as an African-American. It was really difficult to find my place in that, because even not only being ignored at home, but also in my whole K-12 experience.
Yeah.
And people just making assumptions that you know, I wasn't worthy of having that, you know, pushing and attention and support and that kind of thing. And so I had teachers.
College prep support, all that stuff.
I never had that in high
wow.
school. As a matter of fact, no one ever talked to me about
fucking
preparing
amazing.
For SATs. You know, there was no one. I don't even remember who my college advisor was.
Wow.
No one ever interacted with me. It was just kind of this experience, like I'm there, but I'm not part of anything. Mm-hmm. And so there was this assumption that I would not go to college, and basically was told, you know, you're not really college material. Don't worry about that, you know. And so now I have my MBA. It's like, I never really allowed people to define my life for me,
right,
because I knew that if I did that, I'd never accomplish anything. And so I always looked at those situations as a dare.
Yeah.
Like, I dare you to tell me that I can't do something. Mm-hmm. And, you know, that even happened basically becoming a columnist at the Oregonian. You know, when I was first hired, I was hired in management. I was hired from Detroit to come to Portland to be one of the managers in the newsroom.
Yeah.
And so I remember having a conversation with the editor at the time, and we were just talking about, what are your goals? You know, what do you want to do? What do you see yourself here contributing to this newspaper? And I said, well, you know, I'd really like to become a columnist here. And the editor said, well, I don't think so. You know, you're going to have to get in line. You're not really from here. There's a lot of people who want this job. I think you should just, you know, go along the path that you're going not worry about becoming a columnist. You know, and so.
And then you took that as, I'm going to become a columnist.
There you go. Yeah. And so, you know, a couple of years down the line, I get promotions and that kind of thing. They came to me and said, would you like to be a columnist at our paper?
Mm.
You know, and so it just kind of turned around. And that's been kind of, you know, the situation of my life is just not allowing people to, you know, put me in boxes. And so a lot of this reinventing of myself is breaking out of particular boxes. One of the reasons why I left the Oregonian is because I felt like I was kind of in this box. Mm. You know, people saw me, but they didn't really know me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, they didn't know the textures of me.
Yeah.
And there was this assumption that I had always been this outspoken or confident or...
That this was somehow easy for you and just somehow part of your nature. Yeah.
Right. And yeah, it was completely the opposite.
Wow.
So I just felt like I needed to, for all of the little girls out there like who were like me, they needed to know that was not who I am now, was not always what I was, and at that point where I felt the most insecure, that I was more than what I was right at that moment.
Yeah.
And so many more other, you know, folks out there, young people out there, really needed to hear that story. And I just felt compelled to do that. And also I had been dealing with a domestic violence situation.
Yeah.
I needed to get out of that box. So all of this has been like opportunities to just like reclaim who I really feel like I am and then share that with the world.
Was the first thing, you know, you said a lot there I want to go back to, but was the first thing you did when you stepped away from the Oregonian, was that the tangoing with tornadoes? Was that one of the first things you
did? Yes, I would say that was, I had actually done my first play, Tangoing with Tornadoes.
Yeah.
I had done the first full performance of it in 2005.
Okay.
And I was getting request to come and do it as a one-woman show.
Yeah.
And so I knew that I had the opportunity to go to Saipan and do this play.
Wow.
And so I started that and then took it on a sort of a mini tour. Mm. And so that was really the first big thing that I'd done.
Yeah, I think that's amazing that you took it around the world. I got to spend some time in Guam working on a screenplay, and my friend Joan Glang started the first and only rape crisis center in Guam.
Yeah.
And she got a lot of pushback from the locals because the rape was just something your uncle did or something, and it was just an accepted part of the community. And
right.
So when she tried to like start teaching the police how to gather, you know, physical evidence without harming the victim more, to not make the victim sit and retell the story to seven different cops, you know what I mean? And all
right.
of these things that she had to bring there, but the culture on the island, the military culture and then the Chamorro culture, they weren't having
right.
any of it. They really fought her tooth and nail to do that. So Saipan is very similar. You know, the exploitation of children on Saipan
Absolutely.
Is legendary.
Yes,
In the factories and in the sweatshops. And then after that, or before that, as younger girls in forced prostitution and then in sex trafficking and then in the sweatshops. And so
yes.
that's amazing that you were able to bring that there. Was the response Did the women resonate with the message in the play?
Absolutely. Yeah. So I was able to do the play there, and then they had me talking with folks in law enforcement to explain, you know, just what you talked about, that how necessary it is to have this understanding and education about this issue.
Yeah.
And so they had me in the paper. So it's a small island. So everyone recognized me, when I'm going down the street. So, it was they had seen me perform. Someone had from Saipan had seen me perform somewhere else, and that's how I got the invitation to come there. Mm-hmm. But yes, it's really pervasive, and in America too.
Yeah, well, of course.
And particularly in communities of color too. Yeah. We just don't want to talk about it. We don't want to acknowledge that this is going on, because then we have to deal with it.
Right. I want to back up a little bit to your time at the Oregonian, if you don't mind. I think it's amazing, you know, when you were talking about your family. Where did you grow up?
It wasn't Santa Rosa.
Santa Rosa,
Northern California.
Okay. Yeah, that is. That's kind of like white ground zero.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's interesting.
And even more so when I was younger. Yeah. Hmm.
And then you went away to college where?
I went to Florida A&M.
A&M, okay.
And
ended up studying journalism, or
I went there because I got a scholarship in business, and so before I got to Florida A&M, you know, after my father had passed, my mother actually ended up moving us to Portland, Northeast Portland.
Okay.
So we stayed there for a year, and so, you know, she had the 8 kids, and then she was going to marry someone with 8 kids,
ooh,
16 kids, right? So she was looking for a place,
and
kept driving out and out and out, you know, and ended up buying a house in Newburgh.
Wow.
Like, right on the outskirts of Newburgh.
Mm-hmm.
And so I actually went to high school in Newburgh.
Wow.
But for like three and a half years.
Okay.
My two older sisters graduated at 16 because it was such a miserable experience that they took extra credits at the PCC to be able to graduate early. So I left from Portland, Newburgh, and anxiously trying to get out of that environment because it was such a hostile place for me to be.
Unbelievable.
You know, with the kids being able to throw things at me, spit at me, call me names like on a regular basis.
Yeah.
And then I just knew that education was my way to get out of that environment and that experience and make something of myself. So I was able to get a scholarship to Florida A&M, which is a historically black university, in business, because they have a strong business school.
Right, right.
And so I took a journalism course, because you can take electives, and I just wanted to take something around writing to kind of explore that. So the dean of the journalism school said, if you switch your major, then you can go into journalism, and we will pay your full ride.
Mm.
And so that was the best decision that could have happened to me. So that's how I switched my major and became a journalist.
That's amazing to me that somebody, you know, it tells you a little bit, and I want to get into this in the second or third segment about Portland in the Northwest our friend and colleague Walita and Marisha talks a lot about this and about sort of African American history in this region, and it's a difficult history to discuss, and it tells you a little bit about what I think listeners need to know about. Everyone loves Portland. Everyone's moving to Portland. Right. Portland's so hip and happening. But when an African-American girl goes to Florida because it's a better place to be than rural Oregon, then I really think that says something about the state of things in Oregon when you were a teenager, and really probably still right up to this very day.
Yeah.
And then you go on to the Oregonian, and you're nominated for 2 Pulitzers, but to your brothers and sisters, you're still the kid that stole a Pop-Tart from them one time or something, right? I understand how that works, right? They never see it. You're always that kid that you were to them. Yeah, you're not what you're accomplishing. We're going to take our first break. We're sitting with S. Renee Mitchell. This is Andy Gervich. You're listening to On the Block Radio, and we will be right back after this.
Listen, engage, transform with On the Block. Be right back.
Yeah. Women now make up 37% of the workforce, changing their role forever.
Harvard Medical School has now opened its doors to new female applicants.
The first woman is now in space.
The majority of last year's doctorate degrees were earned by women.
We've come so far, but our news is changing for the worse. More women die from heart disease and stroke than men, even though it can be prevented. Make a change at GoRedForWomen.org today. Brought to you by the Ad Council and the American Heart Association's Go Red for Women.
A rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the moon. I can't pay no doctor bills, but Whitey's on the moon. 10 years from now, I'll be paying still while Whitey's on the moon. You know, the man just upped my rent last night, cause Whitey's on the moon. No hot water, no toilets, no lights, but Whitey's on the moon. I wonder why he's upping me, cause Whitey's on the moon. Well, I was already giving him 50 a week, and now Whitey's on the moon. Taxes taking my whole damn check. The junkies make me a nervous wreck. The price of food is going up, and as if all that crap wasn't enough, a rat done bit my sister Nell with Whitey on the moon. Her face and arms began to swell, and Whitey's on the moon. With all that money I made last year for Whitey on the moon, how come I ain't got no money here? Whitey's on the moon. You know, I just about had my fill of Whitey on the moon. I think I'll send these doctor bills, air mail special. To Whitey on the moon.
This is Olympic wrestling champion Mark Schultz, New York Times best-selling author of the book Foxcatcher, and you are listening to On the Block Radio.
Welcome back to the program, everybody. This is your host, Andy Gervich. You're listening to On the Block Radio. Our guest is S. Renee Mitchell. When we left for the break, we were just starting to talk a little bit about your time with the Oregonian and how you came there to actually work in the business office, right? And then,
well, in the business section of the paper.
The business section of the paper, okay.
When they had different sections.
Yeah. Remember? Do you remember when you used to have a labor section and a business section, and then when that changed to just a business section in the United States?
There's been all kinds of changes.
I'm interested. You started working at the Oregonian when? 1998?
Yeah, 1998,
okay.
Yes.
Was William Hilliard still around at that point?
He was not at the paper.
Okay.
He had been retired before I arrived.
Did you ever have any interaction with him?
I did. I actually tried to get an internship at the paper when he was there, but for some reason it just kind of never worked out. I made sure, well, the college made sure that I had, you know, several internships before I graduated, so
okay.
I was very well skilled.
Uh-huh.
But I couldn't, for some reason, get on at the Oregonian.
Isn't that fascinating?
Yes.
That kind of mirrors his story a little bit, doesn't it? I mean, so for our listeners who don't know, and correct me if I have the facts wrong, Hilliard tried to get a job as a paper boy for the Oregonian and was denied because the paper thought that white customers might be alarmed at a black newsboy delivering their paper. And so they told him no. And so he went and started his own student paper. He ended up at Pacific University, I think, and then graduated with a degree in journalism, started his own paper, and then eventually was hired by the Oregonian as a columnist, worked his way up to an editor, and then sometime in the, I think in the 80s, was actually became the editor of the paper.
Mm-hmm.
It's really a remarkable story. Did you meet him and spend any time
with him? I've definitely met him. We've talked together, and I have complete respect for him and all that he has accomplished. I know he has made way for others to come, you know, and follow him there, follow that path. So I really like him, respect him.
Do you feel like you did the same thing? It's hard probably to say about yourself, but for women at the paper, for black women at the paper?
Well,
or just in journalism in general?
I never think about I never think about myself as the first dad.
Yeah.
You know, I know that my mother certainly was very accomplished, and I know that she was always the first Black woman that, you know, whatever.
Mm-hmm.
I just took that as something I'm just supposed to do. And you know, when I think back, I suppose there were a number of opportunities for me to claim that. But I was never really just interested in being the first Black that. I just wanted to do a good job at whatever I was doing.
Do you remember the Dave Chappelle thing when he said, don't ever be the first Black person to do anything? Do you remember when he said that? Because of this, the level of scrutiny and judgment and the fierceness you have to withstand the attacks from, you know, when you're bringing attention to yourself. We have Sister Outsider Poetry coming mm-hmm. to the school mm-hmm. In a couple of weeks, and the Denise Froman poem about Muhammad Ali, and the pushback from a lot of white America about his boastfulness in the 60s, about like, how dare you be so full of yourself? We don't let people that look like you get this far. And so this kind of defiance in the belief he had in himself was really a defiance to a white America that said that African Americans shouldn't be too full of themselves. And I'm really interested in that notion, and I'm interested in your answer to that you weren't thinking necessarily in those frames. You were just trying to be a good journalist and do the work you felt.
Because I couldn't get distracted by that. And I knew it was present. I mean, I would get hate mail at the Oregonian just because my picture was there.
Wow.
And no matter what I wrote about, it didn't have anything to do with race sometimes.
Yeah.
That there would be this assumption that I was talking about race just because they saw my picture as a Black woman.
Mm-hmm.
So there was this constant pressure from outside. But if I let myself get too carried away with that, then, you know, I don't do the work that I'm supposed to be doing.
Right.
And so, yes, and there have been a number of occasions where it's been pointed out, but, you know, there's been stress like that my entire life.
Yeah.
Growing up in all white environments.
Yeah.
And having to confront that. So it wasn't, I guess it wasn't something new or something unusual. This was my life.
Yeah.
To be the only one, you know?
Right.
So the horrific
thing is that you can acclimate to that kind of stuff, and it just becomes a kind of, pardon the pun, but white noise, a kind of static that is always kind of present. You know, that's really fascinating. You were at the paper for 25 years.
Right? I was in journalism for 25
okay.
years. I was at the paper
Well, 98 to 2015 isn't 25 years. Yeah. Right.
To 2008.
Okay.
At the Oregonian.
Okay.
So I was part of that group when they first were doing buyouts that was eligible because I had 10 years there. And I could see the handwriting on the wall.
Yeah.
And I knew that I had enough within me, enough confidence as well as talent, to be able to recreate my life. And so I had to push hard to allow them to give me the buyout, because there were about 180 people who were eligible, but not everyone was wanting to take advantage of it. I mean, it was 2 years of salary and 2 years of health benefits. It was the most generous buyout in the country as far as newspapers are concerned.
Wow.
And so I just wanted to go for it. And then my boss was able to advocate for me because they didn't want to let me go because I was bringing readers and people were looking for my column and that kind of thing. But I knew I needed something different in my life at that point, and it just kind of converged and it just happened, and I'm very grateful.
What were the columns? I have two questions about that. One is, I read somewhere that you said when you start feeling bored, when you challenge yourself, and then when you feel like you've kind of got something down, then it starts to take the next challenge. And I'm wondering, do you remember saying that?
No.
Yeah.
I said a lot of things.
Yeah, I have it somewhere that you said that when you when you feel like you've gotten a hold of something, then this thing in you starts to want to take on the next challenge. And I'm wondering if leaving the paper was a bit of that you felt, okay, I've been doing this journalism
Absolutely.
Thing. I've expressed myself here. I've had some success. Now it's time to show what else I can do.
Right. Yes, there's definitely some truth in that. Mm-hmm. I mean, even in my journalism career, I would stay a place 1 year, 2 years. Mm-hmm. When I was in Detroit, I think I stayed there four and a half years. That had been the longest I had stayed anywhere.
Wow.
And so, yes, I do get this itch of wanting to explore more, expand more, because it's the whole thing of, I don't want to be in a box. So I've been here a long time. So, you know, a long was like 2 years.
Yeah.
I've been here a while. I need to figure out what else is out there.
Yeah.
And how can I expand and grow as a person and as a professional. As an artist. So, yes.
What were the pieces that were nominated for the Pulitzer? What were those about?
Well, they would send like a group of maybe 10 columns.
Okay.
So there was a number of them within those that.
So it's not a particular article. It's
no,
just
it's,
this journalist. So that's kind of nice, because then you're being recognized for a body of work, not just one piece.
Right. And so I would say before I left the paper, the year I left the paper, the Society of Professional Journalists, and mm-hmm. I think that's what you referred to, named me as the number one columnist in 5 states.
Yes.
So it was a great honor, but yet still not enough to keep me there,
mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
because I knew it was time for me to go.
That's a real brave thing to walk away from that, because what, you know, one might feel I got a gig here, you know, I'm in a flow, I have a name, I have a brand, you know. To go start kind of from scratch, even though you still were able to bring those accomplishments with you, that was a courageous choice.
Well, safety is boring to me. You know? I guess that's what you were referring to before. Huh. You know, because I get too comfortable and then I get too stagnant.
Mm.
And lose that edge.
Huh?
In some ways, you know, I don't know if I should joke about this. I think in some ways it's true about having adult ADD, you know, just needing to be able to learn more, to accomplish more. I love being a lifelong learner.
Mm-hmm.
And so I just never want to get in this place where I feel like I know it all or I've experienced it all or you know, that kind of thing. I just want to be able to grow in a lot of different ways. And when we were growing up, you know, maybe that's part of it. My dad would travel, you know, move us looking for jobs, mm-hmm, you know, mm-hmm. So I got very accustomed to not having moss grow under my feet.
Yeah.
You know, so it was maybe part of that too.
I was the same. I moved about every 2 years for most of my life. My dad was in the mob. And so we bounced from New York to California to Florida, back to New York. It was always New York City and then some small town for him to hide out for a couple of years, and then New York and then some small town. And so it was actually quite a disruptive childhood, but I learned to get along with lots of different kinds of people. I became a kind of chameleon, and I developed a sense of humor as a way to try to break down barriers and stuff. And so I got a lot from it, but it was, I got used to moving. I've been in Portland longer than anywhere I've ever been. Speaking of Portland, before we get off of the Oregonian and stuff, and as you said, you wrote about a lot of things, besides race and gender, and but I want to ask you a little bit about, I just want some of your thoughts on the Northwest and on Portland in terms of where we are, where we're going, in terms of race relations here. I mean, I've been here since 1991, and when I was preparing, you know, I brought up Walita Imarisha and others who have done such a great job of bringing, you know, to the forefront a conversation of, you know, her, that great presentation she does, Why Aren't There More Black People in Oregon? And when she talks
She's
about
brilliant.
Vanport and how Portland State actually started as the university in Vanport. And I think about just since I've been here, and then she goes on to talk about all, you know, the curfew laws and all the stuff around the state. But even since I've been here in the 90s, you know, I remember Dora McCrae, and I remember Keaton Otis, and the names, the lists just go on and on. And I'm sure you covered a lot of that stuff. And mm-hmm. when who was it? Daryl Gates was the police chief. Where you were working during those years, right?
Right.
And Gates was.
Was it Gates? His brother Charles, is a drummer.
Oh, was he?
Daryl. But I wonder if it's a different last name. Hmm. I remember him. He's a black police officer.
Oh no, that was Charles Moose.
Charles Moose.
Yeah.
But there was another one.
Yeah. Daryl Gates was the guy who came from Los Angeles and was actually involved, was an L.A. cop at the time of the Rodney King beatings. And several of those police officers came
up. Oh, I was not in Portland at that time.
Yeah, yeah,
yes,
yeah.
That's why I didn't remember him.
But where do you stand? Help us figure out what's going on in Portland with race relations. Because as I see it, things are getting worse in a lot of ways with this new gentrification.
Right.
I just saw on the TV this morning that a one-bedroom apartment in Lloyd Center is $1,800.
Right, right, right. Yeah.
And so things aren't getting better for diverse communities here.
No, they're not getting better. Definitely a lot of folks of color are being pushed out of the city, mm-hmm. mostly for economic reasons.
Yeah.
And so it's this is similar to what's happening in San Francisco,
yeah.
Where there are all very, very few Black people in San Francisco these days. So it just feels like this is continuing to happen, this pattern of pushing folks out who don't have the economic means to stand their ground. And so, you know, I think that that's why I'm so committed to doing the art that I'm doing,
yeah.
because it's so much more inclusive, and it's also intended to be very educational.
Mm-hmm.
You know, I'm involved in, we're trying to create a Vanport 3-day festival next year.
Oh, wow.
To explain, you know, about the history of this area and how that was so instrumental
mm-hmm.
in providing some integration in Portland,
yeah,
and how that reverberates even now, even within the Black community about, oh, you're not really from here,
right.
kind of,
right,
response. So that all dates back to Vanport.
So many people don't know about the thriving Black community that was in the Williams area before
right.
the hospital was built, and now, of course, all the big gentrification on Mississippi and Williams and Vancouver
right.
avenues has changed and pushing people out of
absolutely.
Homes they've been in, businesses they've been in for a couple of generations. Sometimes.
Yes. And, you know, with Williams Avenue, I wrote a libretto called Sherman, a Jazz Opera.
Yeah.
That was about Williams Avenue when it was called Black Broadway. Because
Black Broadway.
So many of the more well-known musicians and singers and entertainers would find their way to a club on Williams Avenue because that's where they would get a Black audience.
There was something that went on there through that time period that was pretty
absolutely.
Exciting. Exceptional in music history. I mean, across the board. Yeah,
definitely,
some of the greats.
Definitely. And so we need to celebrate that. Not many people know about that.
Mm-mm.
And sometimes there's not even a receptivity to those kind of stories and that kind of history with the businesses on Williams Avenue.
Yeah, that's interesting.
You know? And so there are so few at this point businesses, Black-owned businesses. And so, you know, one of the very few handful of Black-owned businesses is now doing an art project because there were some folks, when they had the conversation about the bike lanes,
yes.
who said, we need to acknowledge the history of Williams Avenue
yeah.
and stood their ground, which made room for these two, Kayan and Clive Davis, to be able to now have this project where they're going to create art around the history of Williams Avenue, but without people standing up and saying, you know, this story deserves to be told,
mm-hmm.
that wouldn't be happening.
Yeah.
And so that continues to need to happen, which is why I'm trying to continue to do art that speaks to that and create space to have those conversations.
Mm-hmm.
If we don't take the opportunity to create space for that, it's just not going to happen naturally.
And a place that charges, you know, $14 for a scoop of ice cream is probably not going to be interested in having a conversation about the history of the area and the
right.
people that it's displaced.
Right.
To do that. You
and
know what I mean?
So we just need to keep talking about it. And
I mean, I remember when that shooting happened on Alberta right in front of the Salt and Straw. And you remember the white people were mad because the police tape was up and they couldn't get in to get their ice cream, let
right.
alone a dead Black kid in the street. You know,
right.
And
right.
you know, our friend Sean Davis, who runs the American Legion, was beside himself when he heard about that. And
right.
was kind of raging, like, what's going on? And that really is my question, is places like San Francisco and Portland present themselves as these liberal, enlightened cities, and yet you bring it up as having a similar phenomenon in
mm-hmm.
both places.
Mm-hmm.
And it's kind of like the Willamette River. There's this, we present ourselves as these, you know, environmentally conscious people, and yet we have a Superfund site river right here in the town. And I think the same thing is happening with race in this city, is everyone wants the Portlandia, you know, white liberal hipster vibe for here. It's good for business. It's good for the image. It's good for articles on the New York Times about
right.
how cool Portland is and how many bike lanes we have and all that. But no one, very few people are open to these dialogues about understanding the actual real history of race in this city. And I think it's important because my question is, are we just doomed to keep repeating this as a city, or is there something we can do? I remember Martin Luther King said in Letter from Birmingham Jail that he was becoming, I mean, this was in the 60s, that he was becoming convinced that it's not these hood wearing, Klan member, right wing maniacs that are going to be the real problem for integration and for civil rights. It's white moderates. He goes, I'm completely convinced that it's these white folks that are, trying to help. Oh, we get you. We get what you're saying. We understand. It's these people that are going to be the real obstacle to change. Well-meaning whites, but who just can't really understand the full, the full paradigm shift that needs to happen to get to a place of equality and social justice. And so, do you have any thoughts on what we can do?
And the whites who don't speak up when aren't really cognizant of what's actually happening. There's sometimes these blinders that go up. So, if they're not talking about it, and we have this narrative like Portlandia, then that's going to be the pervasive belief that this is what Portland is all about.
Yeah.
So it's important that those who are silent speak up.
Yeah.
And hold space, and have these dialogues, and continue to protest in whatever way that seems natural for them. In my way, protesting is by doing my art, is by creating paintings or creating plays or creating, poetry about, creating space for me in this environment, in this Portlandia kind of imaginary, world that really isn't what it is.
Yeah.
And so, I've gotten a little people, upset, but I've done that as a columnist, just speaking truth, and people think that's courageous, and I just think that's telling the truth.
Yeah, absolutely.
And that's the way it should be, And so, even going back to literary art, so I've been a writer a long, long time. And there are a number of organizations who claim to support writing or bringing in more voices, but they're not diverse. A lot of the creative organizations are not diverse. And so, there was this initiative that was started, I think, by the mayor, that there would be a requirement that the creative organizations diversify their boards, diversify their programming, diversify their audiences. And so where did that go? What happened to that? There was money put to that. Mm-hmm. And it just feels like, we talk about these things, like we talk about being an inclusive community. I think that's in now within the city charter or something, where we're saying we want to be an inclusive community. Well, those are just words.
Yeah.
If there's not anything put to that to actually make it happen. So we do a lot of that in Portland. We talk a lot.
A lot of lip service. Yeah, we were talking before the show started about this show and my desire to have the audience for this show support the guests that come on and support the artists they hear, because we can talk about social justice, we can talk about equality, we can click like on a status update about a police brutality or something, but if we're not allocating resources and really doing what we can to fund and support substantially these kinds of programs, we're not doing anything. And we're about to go to our next break, but I just wanted to say one of the things in our final segment, I really want to start getting into what you're doing now and the art and, your website. I want to direct our listeners to, because I spent a couple of hours on that thing last night and probably only got a third of the way through it.
Right.
It is so well done, and there's
thank you.
Much great content on there and so many access points for people to connect with your art and the projects you're doing and to support that. And it's a delight. I think you're doing a great job with
thank
that.
Thank you
and
so much.
You've taught yourself some graphics design skills.
Oh, yes,
as well,
I do.
Right?
I do mostly all of my graphic arts. I do my website design, and I design websites for other people.
Wow.
I create posters and memes, and I've learned to do all of that, because if I depend on others, it doesn't really get done, or it doesn't get done the way that I'd like it to be done. Mm. So I've had to teach myself.
The author, this is my second and final TED Talk reference for the interview, and then we're going to go to break. But the author, Chimamanda Adichie, has that wonderful TED Talk, Danger of a Single Story.
Absolutely.
And she talks about the danger of a single story that many people have, many Americans have, of Africa, is that is a story of catastrophe. And that this is, the especially after European colonialization, this is true, but this is not the only story. And And I think there's a danger for people like myself who are white and want to be an advocate to, we share stories about police brutality. I'm still I'm still freaking out about the his name's escaping me, Tamir Rice, you know, the 12-year-old boy in Cleveland.
Right.
And we get so fired up over these instances, you know, Ferguson and all of this stuff, and where people are being harmed and killed and jailed and mass incarceration, and all of that needs attention, and all of that needs real change, and it needs real change now. And I applaud groups like the Black Lives Matter group for saying this needs to change now. But I think the danger is that we can fall into a place where this is the only thing we're talking about with the African-American community,
right,
is stories of catastrophe. And that strips away all of the creativity and all of the power and all of the triumph and all of the transformation and all of the stories of beauty and art and creativity,
right,
that also come along. And so one of the things I appreciate about your art is I feel it's very balanced, is that you engage a lot of these things head on, and you don't shy away from the political or, you know, the places where systematically people of color are being marginalized. But your art is also not just about that. It's about beauty and transformation and empowerment and finding a voice and growing that voice in spite of all of those obstacles.
And
that was an intentional thing for you, yeah?
Oh, absolutely important to me. Because, you know, I have all different kinds of layers. And there's so much beauty out there that I see in the midst of what, you know, the trauma and the chaos and the conflict. And I just feel as an artist, you know, it is my role to take the pain and create something beautiful out of it. And that's also the story of my life. You know, the traumatic things that I have dealt with, from the death of a parent to a sexual assault to domestic violence to being hit by a car and almost lost my life,
wow,
to all kinds of heartbreaking things. You know, I could wallow in racism is a big part of that. And I could certainly wallow in that and be an angry, bitter person. But I have found that art is a way for me to take all of those traumatic experiences, all of those painful things, all of those ugly things, and then to create something beautiful out of it. And I think that that's the transformational power of art, which is what I'd like to communicate to other people. So I have to reflect what the message that I want people to receive, that there is beauty there, and I want people to see that beauty.
Wonderful. We're going to take our final break. You're listening to On the Block Radio. This is your host, Andy Gervich. We're sitting with Renee Mitchell. And do you have time to stay with us for one more segment?
I do.
That's wonderful.
Hopefully I'll share a poem then.
Yes, you're going to share a poem, and we're going to talk a little bit about the 500 projects you have going on at the moment. All right, folks, thanks for listening to On the Block Radio. We'll be right back after this.
This is Mike Crenshaw, and you are listening to On the Block Radio.
No other truth but mine. Right here, right now, in front of this mic, I stand clothed in authenticity, admittedly devoid of objectivity, yet desperately seeking connectivity with you, my audience. I am wearing my naked truth, with one foot in sparkly spike heels and the other in crusty combat boots. I'm going to recite my poem to you like nothing else matters, and make every other poet sound like one-year-old babblers. Because when I deliver my spoken word, I incite inspiration and imagination. Flashes of brilliance in my metaphors are delightfully perceptible. Here and now, I'm not the girl who spent her life being barely acceptable. If she straightened her hair and got rid of that gap in her teeth, she'd be almost pretty. When I'm spitting my verse into this steel receptacle, I'm pouring love into your ear, and I don't care if it's reciprocal. See, I'm not trying to reshape myself to fit your personal reality. Why would I even waste my divine energy trying to explain or defend whatever you think is wrong with me? Because being a black woman in this society has taught me that my truth matters most when I am feet flat, chin up in front of the microphone, standing alone, feeding off your energy like a death row inmate sucking on his last fried chicken bone. Because outside of this inch and a half of electric air, my truth is too tough to swallow, too hard to hear, and I wonder sometimes, what if someone had come to my high school and encouraged me to embrace my unreliable reality, teach me to represent my disregarded feelings linguistically, using words that rhyme or don't rhyme as long as they kept time with my heartbeat? Because when you can discover the right simile, you don't need anybody else's sympathy. Writing poetry helps you communicate clearly, fearlessly, with efficiency. Then you can write circles around anyone who dares attack your vulnerability. If someone had shared that wisdom with me, maybe then I would have known how to battle bigotry stylistically, convincingly, while still having the foresight to maintain my dignity. Instead, I was still haunted by whatever the hell people found wrong with me. I spent so much of my growing up years being unheard, disregarded, lonely, ignored, invisible. See, at home I was brown-skinned, knock-kneed, sullen. Coarse strands of defiant black-brown curls escaped from my rubber-banded lopsided ponytails. She looked like me, that young girl in the bathroom mirror, hurriedly scraping a toothbrush across her gap-toothed smirk. I ran 2 blocks, skipped every other stair, then walked slowly as to not draw ire. I sat, smiling at my desk on the front row. I saw my teacher, white-haired, grandmotherly, same birthday as mine. I grinned even wider that day. Ooh, 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 I know, I said, wiggling my hand like it was on fire. Then the dance began. First, her eyes averted away from me. Then her legs shifted around my yawning absence, as did the rest of the students who looked like her. They all repeated the same dance, every one of them, in the classroom, on the playground, in the lunchroom. I decided I must check out that mirror again, just to make sure I actually exist. See, I don't share this deep-seated pain with you as a point of shame or pity or blame, but to remind you that whatever truth sits within you, whatever sorrow, heartbreak, guilt, or regret that pushes against your consciousness like a repulsive, pus-filled pimple, it will escape from you one day, somewhere, somehow, at some point. Whether it's in the fights you go searching for, the high you seek from your parents' prescription pills, the sorrow you drown in the gin you drink underneath the basketball bleachers, or the stripes you slice against your arm, because it's the only way to overtake the pain you feel in your heart. Your truth, the only truth that matters, is there within you, always, waiting for the moment it can fashion its escape. And what I have come to realize is that writing has helped me find my way back to myself. So that when my throbbing pimple bursts with creative intention, pushing out a fountain of wildly exploding seepage, I can decode that pain and shape it into stimulating sentences, sublime rhymes, and interesting alliterations that will hit you square in the face and you cannot turn away. You wouldn't even want to. See, we all have a story to tell. And your truth, your individual truth, is your best acne medication. So write your reality, then stand tall as you spit your words into this mic. Spit, write, truth only, just do you.
We'll be right back.
Welcome back to the program, folks. This is Andy Gervich, listening on the Block Radio. We are in our final segment with S. Renee Mitchell. And would you like to start us off this segment, maybe by reading us a piece? Or do you want to do it a little later, at the end of the segment?
Well, I could do it now. This is actually a piece that I pulled up on my website. It was a poem that I wrote. Erykah Badu was in town, and she was speaking at the Black Midwives event, and so I was commissioned to do a piece, which I often do, to bring art into an environment. So I wrote a piece called Healing Hands,
and oh, that's great.
That just came up as I was strolling through my website. Can I share that with you?
I would love it.
I wonder if you have ever taken the time to celebrate your hands. You who are our Black midwives, doulas, wisdom warriors, carriers of history in your palms. Even the tiniest crevices of your fingertips have stories. As the customary keeper of women's business, you carry this divine knowledge across the middle passage, burrowed beneath your braids and bosoms, and when we reached America's shores, you reminded us of how roots make the best medicine. Even when we decided to love our newborn babies to death rather than deliver them into certain bondage, you taught Black women how to whisper midnight prayers, call out to ancient lineages of ancestors, and christen our intention with drumming and cultural rituals. When we needed to be held through our grief, your sacred hands were there, without judgment or pretense, wiping our tears, embracing our weeping shoulders, healing our broken hearts. Your hands are the wings of God. Black midwives, do you know how much we need your hands? Depend on your hands. Revere your hands. You who are most familiar with the craft of womanhood. With sitting stool and sharp scissors, kindness and innate knowing, you carry the unexplainable expertise of how an expectant woman moves and moans just so, when the timing is just right. Then you wipe our brows with compassion as we cry out in loving surrender. Black midwives, your hands are the first to touch this tiny miracle while still enclosed in its bloodied channel and carry it across threshold from womb to world. Your hands deliver us, emancipate us, liberate us. There is something deeply spiritual about all the genius that your hands hold. Black midwives, I wonder if you have ever caressed your hands in the tender way that you would stroke a swollen breast to release the milk from a plugged duct. Have you ever even looked at them, really looked at the lines of them, the peaks and the valleys of them, the weatheredness of skin and scratches and scars, and taken pride in your hands' selfless service to our mighty race? Black midwives, doulas, wisdom warriors, keep teaching and believing, recruiting and pushing for social change. Keep fighting for the right policies and traditional birthing practices, because these doting hands of yours that lovingly catch Black babies make for better birth outcomes, because one cannot infuse or inject affection for dark skin into a classroom textbook or a medical degree. It is already there in our melanin, in our hearts, and in our hands. Your hands, Black midwives, are instruments of revolution.
Oh, yeah, we're getting the fist power from Celeste in the background there. Yeah, that was wonderful. Thank you for sharing that.
Thank you.
That actually leads me to a question. One of the things I think is really interesting about the work you're doing is that you do a lot of work as a community health advocate, right? And I've read several of the projects you've worked on. As a survivor of domestic violence, you've talked about you co-founded a domestic violence resource center here in Portland. Have worked on several empowerment projects for African-American, especially African-American women, to be able to start talking about this and to seek available resources, although they're nowhere near as many as there should be. The depression project you did a couple of years ago, I think that was in 2009, 2010. this I found fascinating, and I wanted to really ask you about both of them, and you can take the answer any direction you want. But my understanding of this is that you were teaming with OHSU. to work on a project about depression in African American women.
It was actually a community-based participatory research project.
Okay.
And Christina Nicolaitis was the primary investigator. Mm-hmm. And because it was community-based, there was a requirement to engage community members.
Okay.
Because she didn't want to study people. She wanted to engage people.
Okay.
And so we looked at that issue of depression and how could we influence that. Mm-hmm. That was what the research was all about, through culturally specific kinds of interventions. And so we, as a part of that, at the end of the project, we were able to document that we had reduced depression scores in Black women by some of the things that we were doing.
Wow.
And one of the things was writing. There was also an event that was held that was called Redefining the Blues. That was when Senator Avell Gordley spoke for the first time publicly about her bout with depression and social anxiety and domestic violence. And people needed to hear that someone who had accomplished so much still had some issues that she was dealing with on an everyday basis.
Yeah.
And so that was part of the intention to really break down what this issue was, depression, because we call it the blues and we normalize it.
Right.
Like it's just part of being a woman, you know? And
you talked about the strong Black woman archetype as well, that
absolutely.
You're just supposed to stiff upper lip and nothing gets to you.
We don't like to admit that we're weak. There's this expectation we have to carry their community, our family, each other, without acknowledging that we need rest, that we need support, that we need help and intervention. And so, you know, even with that, all of that is related to some of the art that I do and created the Strong Black Women Anthem that is on YouTube that talks about, you know, we love our man, we hate our bus, but they both treat me bad, you know, and how we need to start taking care of ourselves and acknowledge, you know, you see me and you'll ask how I'm doing and I'll say, oh, I'm just fine, when really I'm really hurting inside.
Yeah.
And so, you know, we need to be honest with each other. And that was why I came out as a survivor of domestic violence and sexual assault, because we need to be honest about these things and talk about these things. And even in the midst of that, having people who would tell me, don't, you know, that's a private family matter. Don't discuss that in public, you know, which was a dare. Mm-hmm. I dare you to tell me not to talk about this. And so that's how the play came out. That's how the CD came out, you know. So we have to, I have to, I believe, talk about these things that no one wants to talk about, because it's not like it's not there. It's just we're kind of ignoring it or glossing over it, and that's not healthy.
No, and then it becomes the pink elephant in the collective room of our culture.
Absolutely.
And I think I have a couple of friends who, you know, this thing you're talking about, I think, is a real pressure for women in our culture, but I think even more so for women of color. And I have two friends who do really interesting work. Richard Katz, Dr. Richard Katz, has a book called Synergy, Healing, and Empowerment, and Denita Anderson has a book called The Colo, which is about women in Eastern Europe, and Richard's work is on the Kalahari Kung, and both of them are showing how community healing, especially with indigenous people, is focused on this kind of, not on the zero-sum aspect like our healing, like our disease system is in the United States, but that community healing, especially in traditional cultures, involves a kind of collectivity and holding space for one another's stories.
Right.
And the healing comes through that identification and through the shared burdens and through the recognition that you're not alone.
Absolutely.
But we don't have those things built into our culture. In fact, it's the opposite here. We have things to further marginalize really everyone into these little isolated, you know, automatons. But when you're a part of the dominant culture, there are maybe some outlets for you to find some kind of semblance of peace and order. But when you're now part of a marginalized culture who then experiences abuse or domestic violence, and that it just magnifies all of that stuff. And so you're absolutely right. I read an article recently that actually said, it was a study done at Johns Hopkins on, it was diabetes and stroke and heart attack in Black women. And what the study looked at was how epigenetics is actually influenced these outcomes, and how living a life of social pressures and racism has actually led to the expression, a higher expression of diabetes, stroke, and heart attack in women of color. It's actually caused by their experience of being in the culture and always feeling unsafe or separate or monitored or despised.
Right.
And this is remarkable and terrifying to me. This is actually changing people's health.
Right. Absolutely.
That
there
pressure.
There was actually a whole documentary series on that.
Really?
Oh, yes. Oh, yes. As a community health worker, I went through that training where we watched the documentary.
Yeah.
And it's absolutely rings true with me.
Mm.
And you know, the fact that, you know, I had an advanced degree and I had, a great career and still worrying about, you know, being able to carry my child and having a healthy delivery, you know, or being able to just, you know, not, you know, have to suffer from depression because of all of the microaggressions and things I deal with every day. It's a lot of stress. And the only way that I've really felt like I've been able to live a healthy and productive life is through art because I've been able to find my place in that, and I've been able to find healing and release in that because it's not easy being me.
It's not easy
being a black woman, you know, in Portland.
Yeah.
And feeling like people can come up and touch your hair.
I was just going to ask about that. The hair, the touching of natural hair as if it's some kind of exhibit.
Right.
You know, as if people have that kind of access. It's something similar to the touching of a pregnant woman's belly, but it's somehow more obscene to me.
Right, because of the history of it.
Yeah.
You know, and so that happens regularly. So I've written poetry about
Don't touch
my hair.
Yeah.
You know, and this is how I deal with it. Because
I'm laughing out of terror, not because it's funny. Yeah, yeah. That's a real thing in Portland.
It happens sometimes without even people being aware of what they're doing.
Yeah.
And how offensive that it is.
Right. And that's what's even scarier, is if you said to them how horrible it was, they would actually be shocked.
Right.
Yeah, that really blows my mind. I want to ask you about your work with children, because I asked you before, what can we do in a place like Portland to change course? And I think sometimes I feel like it, you know, despite best intentions, it might be too late for a lot of us geezers, right? A lot of us idiots might just be too old to change. But your work with young people, I really think... is phenomenal stuff. I just want to bring up a couple of things for our audience. You designed a curriculum for a week-long high school camp on social justice. Mm-hmm. I want to ask you about the children's book in particular, and also your work with Spitwright, excuse me, and the Portland Youth Poet Laureate work. That's similar. Right. That's the same thing, right? Is Spitwright the same as that?
Spitwright is similar to the, yeah.
Okay.
Spitwright is the umbrella organization.
Okay.
And then we have the Youth Poet Laureate project. Okay. And then we have the what I call the What You Want to Do crew, which came out of a partnership with Portland Parks because they were trying to figure out, okay, so our community is diversifying and changing, but our programming isn't.
Right.
And so they wanted to know from youth what it is that they want to have in their community centers, but they had never asked the question.
Yeah.
So they kind of contracted with a number of groups, and then they contracted with me. So those groups did things like have a survey or have an event. And I wanted to do something that was much more grassroots, much more engaging. And so I created this performance crew called the What You Want to Do crew. And they came up with their songs and lyrics because they wanted to first get your attention and engage you in, you know, what they were, the questions that they wanted to ask.
Yeah.
And then once they've gotten your attention and there's kind of an easy exchange, then to ask the questions and have the conversation.
Okay.
To me, it's the difference between standing across the street and yelling and saying, hey, I got all this great stuff that, you know, you want to see and you want to be involved in. And the difference between that and going across the street and shaking someone's hand and saying, you know, having that conversation.
Hmm.
So those two things are a part of what Spitwright has been doing. I started this in April.
It's brand new.
It's brand new. It came out of a conversation, and it basically was an opportunity for me to prove what I've been saying all along, that we need to be able to, one, make space for youth voice, and then to prepare youth to be in that space, to inject them into adult spaces so we can hear their views and their what they're thinking and their talent and that kind of thing. And so I've been trying to get organizations to kind of acknowledge this. Mm. And it was happening very, very slowly. So this opportunity came up to be a part of this national program called the Youth Poet Laureate program, which had been trying to get into Portland. They're in 30 or more cities right now. And so I took it on as an individual and brought some people along. But in other cities, they have organizations who take this on, like a library or a literary arts similar organization. But here it was just a group of individuals who felt very strongly about promoting youth voice. And so we had no budget. And we just did it by leveraging our networks.
There's never any money for good things
But there will be.
Yes.
Because I think what we did is we showed what can happen to empower young people and transform them. Because I've seen the difference between the group of kids that we were working with from when we first started until in September, late September, when we had the competition, the growth and the confidence. That's the kind of thing I was going for. Because I could see I was that kid that didn't have the confidence, and now I'm seeing these kids who are just blossoming, and we're putting them into spaces. We'll be at Wordstock. We've had some of our youth speak at 3 national conferences so far. We're getting calls all the time. How can we get your youth engaged? Because we know when they show up, they're going to be able to represent. And what, you know, I was the judge for Verslandia this year, which is the city's largest youth poetry slam. And the first 2 kids who got up there on stage said there maybe a line or two and got embarrassed or they forgot and they ran off the stage. It was a humiliating experience. I never want that for any of our youth. And so there needs to be a preparation for them for those kinds of opportunities.
Absolutely.
And so that's what we're doing with Spitwrite. We have writing and performance workshops, and then we have the competition, but we're working with them throughout this this competition phase. And then afterwards, so we named 2, which is unusual because every other place, every other city is only named 1. They couldn't decide because I knew that there was talent in Portland. And so the judges couldn't decide between the talent. So now we have 2 laureates.
That's amazing.
And I'm also, you know, the other 12, the other 10 students, giving them opportunity as well. So they've been speaking at the Post Legion, you know, a couple times and at other events. And
I'd love to bring them to the college.
I would love to have them, but I have to warn you that every time I have these poet laureates or poet ambassadors speak, they get paid. Because I'm trying to help them understand to treat themselves as artists, as professional artists, because they're stepping into something where they're prepared to be there in front of the mic. Yeah. Their words are important, and they need to be recognized for that. So, you know, I'm teaching them as entrepreneurs to you know, to understand that as long as they have talent, there is a way for them to make
God,
money.
God, that is spectacular. Yeah.
So we have a book, that a chat book that we've developed, like all of the poet ambassadors have contributed 2 poems, and we put that together in a book called My Voice Matters. And there's also a DVD of their performance. One of the other unusual things about what we did with Spitwrite is that in the competition, we didn't want it just to be kids competing against each other. We wanted to build a community of young poets who support each other and help each other get better. And so they were they were required, which they went along with, to come up with a collaborative performance out of nothing where they would both recognize the talents that each other was bringing to the table, whether it was speaking another language or having music, you know, being able to play the guitar, for example, or being able to sing. So we brought all of those talents together and said, okay, here is the format. It is all about youth voice, and I want you to come up with something. And, you know, we gave them standards and that kind of thing. But what they came up with is phenomenal.
Really?
It was so emotionally dense and just, you know, my voice matters. Listen to me. Just because I'm young doesn't mean you ignore me. Give me the pen. I'll write my own story. And that's what they did. And that video of their performance is on our website, www.spitwrite.com.
And they can get the DVD and the
DVD and the chat book. And for every set that's sold, we're selling the set for $20. $10 goes back to the youth poets.
That's just remarkable.
It's we're just wanting to make sure, because one of the poet laureates, for example, is going away to college, and she's thinking, how am I going to make money? Where am I going to work? And I'm saying, here's an opportunity to make as much money as you want, by being able to promote your art.
By being paid for your art.
For doing something that she loves to do anyway.
And that she's good at and works hard at and trains for. Yeah,
absolutely. And because when we talk about these youth are our future leaders, right, it's really true. But how are we being intentional about giving them the skills that they need to be leaders?
Yeah.
You know, for me, that it's all about authenticity. If this is what I say that I want, then I need to create space for that, an opportunity for that.
I couldn't agree with you more, and I think this is one of my favorite things that you're doing. And in a second, I want to ask you about the children's book. But before we move off of that, the analogy that comes to me is the story from earlier in the year, and I'm forgetting, forgive me if it was in Ferguson or in Baltimore, but there was a young African-American man, teenage guy, who was out on the street and he was protesting. It was either the Freddie Gray killing or the Baltimore or the Ferguson stuff. And his mother came and got him, remember, and smacked him around.
Right.
And without, you know, we're short on time, and so I don't want to go off into the weeds. But I was one of the things that, since I brought it up, that bothered me about that story is the sort of glee a lot of my white friends had at watching another black person be hit. And I was like, you know, at the end of the day, this is not a funny story. But more to the point with what you're working on, because there was this, you know, Anderson Cooper, everyone went to the kid's house, and it was this kind of shaming exercise, like, don't you know you should listen to your mom and stay home? And I'm not prepared to criticize the mother, because I don't know what it's like to be an African-American woman who's terrified that your son's going to be killed. And so I'm not prepared to criticize her, but I think the media really dropped the ball there, because the story should be, okay, if this family is going to pull this kid off the street for his safety, then the next, then think about that for a second. He's not safe out there expressing himself. So then the two questions that come up to me, why is he not safe out there expressing himself? And how can we create an environment for him to be safe expressing what he feels about his surroundings and his government and his city and his chances of having a meaningful, safe life? And so it's not just bring the kid home and shut him up. It's how can we find a vehicle for that child to express the anger and the outrage and the fear and the passion that he has, because just to silence him, I think, is not the story.
It's
and so you're providing the avenue for folks, not you alone, but you and the groups you're working with are.
Right. Absolutely. Because I don't believe it's just up to the white community to figure it out or to create that safe space.
Mm-hmm.
It really needs to be to the people who have these talents and these ideas to create that safe space as
well.
Absolutely. So even, you know, you had talked about you don't know what it's like for a black woman. I live with that, you know, and part of that anxiety after I saw the story about Oscar Grant, that movie that came out.
Yeah.
This was even before the Trayvon Martin. So I felt really wiped out, like emotionally, you know, they were going to call the paramedic. I was just like crying. I couldn't. So out of that, I created my Black Sons and Daughters Are Worthy project that was funded by Regional Arts and Culture Council, where we as black parents were able to create poetry that reminded us what were our hopes and dreams for our children when they were born, and had a 3-line template where parents were filling out, even if they weren't poets, it was so easy for them to do because, you know, we made it easy.
Yeah.
Where we would say, okay, my child comes from, you know, when we talked about our rituals or our traditions, our meals together, we talked about interesting people in your family, and then my son is worthy, my black son is worthy, or my black daughter is worthy, honor him. And then what we did is created an event where we had dancers and we had singers and we had music, live music and drumming, and we had poets reciting the poetry from these parents from the community. It was an empowering thing. But we also, as members of the community who recognize that our children are unsafe, need to be doing these things that provide ways for us to honor our children, but also provide opportunities for them to be expressive, to find their place, to find their spark. because art has taken out of the schools, particularly in Portland. So I didn't know, you know, that I was an artist, right? So where would I have gone to find that out and to remind myself of that?
Right.
You know, it just came happenstance, right? So we need to be a, we need to take ownership of that. So another one of the things that I'm doing is we have a, I have a National Endowment for the Arts grant where we're going to have these conversations about how do we create access to creative opportunities for our youth. And start talking about that and then leading to a permanent facility where that can happen. We did have that, the Albina Arts Center.
Yeah.
But funding was, again, an issue. Issue where, you know, it's no longer the case. But that was where Dr. Thara Memory met Janice Scroggins, and it they were a whirlwind together. They worked together, and she was, you know, was able to meet Linda Hornbuckle. It just, it was transformational for this community about the investment of arts and music, that those that happened because of they were able to connect.
Our listeners who aren't from the Northwest really need to look those names up and learn about Thara Memory and Linda Hornbuckle and some
Dr.
of these people.
Dr. Thara Memory.
Yes, Dr. Excuse me. Excuse me. There it is.
Yes.
Yeah, Dr.
He's
Thara
amazing.
Memory. I want to ask you in our closing moments a couple of things. I want to hear about your children's book.
So my children's book is called The Awakening of Sharon, a Cheyenne Brown Supergirl. And it reflects back to some of my experiences as a child. But what brought that up was I was teaching at King's School, and I was teaching kindergarten and first grade. And I go through this thing where when I first introduce myself to the kids and trying to learn their names, I have them say a name that describes, a word that describes them, an adjective, using the first letter of their first name. So Renee would be Rhythmic Renee. I like rhythm, so Rhythmic Renee. So in my mind, it helps me connect something about that person to their name,
That's
and it
cool.
helps me remember their name.
Yeah.
So I was going around the room, and I was asking kids to give me an adjective, and they were having a hard time coming up with something. So I would offer suggestions like creative, you know, creative Karen or brave Brian or, you know, those kind of things. Very encouraging, empowering adjectives. And I was getting a lot of kids who were just shaking their heads. No, no, they couldn't relate to it. And it, for me, it was heartbreaking because they couldn't own something that was powerful and empowering
about themselves.
About themselves at kindergarten and first grade.
Jesus.
And so I went home. I was just so sad. And it reminded me so much of myself, right? How I was at their age, that I wrote this book called The Awakening of Sharon. So this girl finds herself, finds her voice because she's been picked on and bullied. When she finds her voice, she becomes a superhero. And then she teaches other kids that superhero powers are something all of us have within ourselves. So gratitude, friendliness, kindness, you know, compassion, sense of humor are all superpowers. And when we attach that label to them, it kind of gives this different energy to those values that we need to be teaching anyway. And so
if the folks at Pixar are listening, I think this should be one of their next films, by the way, if they want to contact you.
Oh, that'd be great.
I think it's brilliant. Yeah.
Yeah. I love this story. I've been asked also to make a play out of it.
Oh, great.
So it's, you know, it's all in rhyme. And after I wrote this story, I was just trying to figure out how I was going to actually get it out into the market because it needs pictures.
Yeah.
You know? And so I was visiting my girlfriend in LA and she said, you know, you do everything else. Why don't you just draw your own pictures?
Wow.
Because I, you know, I really couldn't afford to hire an illustrator. And so I just started playing around and then realized, oh, this is really fun. And then just drew all of my own pictures.
Wow.
And I love what's been created. But in some ways, I feel like because I gave myself permission, I was able to kind of channel it. And for me, it was just a spiritual exercise of just kind of being grounded and in tune with what my mission was. You know, I feel like I'm driven by what I call heart.
Yeah.
With art in all caps, because what I'm doing right now is a heart mission. It's a very spiritual journey of being able to help people tap into their own creativity and then give that back into the world. What I do with youth and what I do with this children's book. So I, of course, have songs with the children's book. I have written exercises, you know, that they can find their own superhero powers.
Wow.
And then we have opportunities to create masks and capes. And then we have a song that we sing together that's empowering, that the parents stand around their children and they sing saying, you know, you're a superhero and you're so special. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we've done these superhero awakening ceremonies where the parents have contacted me and said, you know, my kid didn't want to take off their mask. They kept singing the song over and over and over again because, you know, we all need to infuse all of that love and compassion and belief in our children. And sometimes we ignore children's voices because they're young. You know, it's the whole thing, children should be seen and not heard.
Yeah.
I heard that my whole life.
Yeah.
And so no one was paying attention to what I had to say. And I just believe that is not, we need to do the opposite, that we need to be listening to our children's voices, because it's not like they don't have anything to say. It's just that we're not paying attention. And which is why I do this work I do with Spitwright, because the poems that these kids are coming up with are incredible and powerful. And, you know, it's just,
you do it to change them, but it ends up changing you, right?
Absolutely. Yeah, yeah. And it's healing to me too, because it's healing that little girl that spent so much of her life unheard, you know, uncared for.
And I think it's so remarkable in our closing minutes here that you're doing this, because, you know, I've read you say in a few interviews that, you know, journalism helped pull you out of that shyness because it forced you to go talk to people and interview people. And the theater forced you out of another element of it because you had to learn to project and to have a presence in front of people and all of that. And so those opportunities really helped pull you out of, excuse me, that shy, awkward person who didn't believe in themselves or had that.
Right.
And thank God, whatever it was and the things you've been sharing with us, that you had that drive, that you pursued those opportunities in spite of all that negative imaging, because it could have been just as easy for you to believe that about yourself and never go expose yourself to those opportunities, and you never would have learned what you were capable of and what you had to share with the world.
True.
And how many of these kids are on the border of that or already well down the road? When you're saying 5-year-olds, 6-year-olds can't think of anything positive about themselves.
Right.
I mean, this is a very important work, and I'm sure you know that, but it's spectacular that you're doing it.
Yes, I feel like it's important, and I want to be able to inspire other people to do it. So when people look at my art and they say, or my work in the world, and say, I really admire that, I really inspired by that, I appreciate those comments, but what I really want is for people to say, I admire that and inspired by that to do something, and this is what I'm doing because what I saw you do.
Yeah.
I mean, I feel like that's really what I'm trying to get to.
And that was the next thing I was going to say, is one of the things that blows me away about you, probably the biggest thing, is that you'll have an experience, you'll have an emotion, and then it's like, and that led me to this project, and that led me to start this organization, and that led me to write this play.
Right.
It isn't just, oh, that's terrible. Oh, that's sad. Oh, that should be different. You're not letting any grass grow under those feet. You're getting after it. If it's not you, then who? And if everybody had that mentality, what a different world we would live in.
Absolutely.
Absolutely. In our final question, I have two questions for you.
Okay.
One is, I want to ask, and this is probably the faster one, where can people find your work? Is it on the website the best place to go?
Yes, I have two websites, which is my personal website, which is www.reneemitchellspeaks.com. That's RENEEMITCHELLSPEAKS, as in talks, speaks.com. That's my personal website. My website where I work with youth is called Spit Right. Now, spit is the spitting into the mic. It's a performance term. So it's www.spitwrite.com.
Okay.
And on that site, they can find videos of the different poets, and they could find all kinds of stuff we're doing.
And we're going to link to both of those sites in our show notes for this episode as well, so listeners have every opportunity to get at that.
Oh, I also have another site. I forgot about this.
Oh, great.
So www.myblacksonsareworthy. They can find more about this project and see a video of what we had accomplished and also order their own souvenir posters. So myblacksonsareworthy, oneword.com.
Mm. That's great.
Thank you.
What a great site, too. What a great name. The last question I have for you, thank you for being with us, by the way.
This has been a
wonderful, wonderful talk. Thank you for your work, too. And, yes, you are inspiring to action in this room and hopefully to everybody that listens to this program
thank
as well.
Thank you. That makes me feel good.
You have been, as I said in the introduction, I was really interested in the creative revolutionists and then the creative healing griot. And I'm probably mispronouncing it, but
you've got it.
I charged a previous guest on this show, David Gonzalez, with being a griot, and he roundly rejected it because of the respect he has for the griot position. He says, I'm a storyteller. I know real griots, but I'm not one of them. And I became aware of this position watching the film I'll Sing for You about Karkar, about Boubacar Traoré, the singer, the Mali singer. Mm-hmm. What the griot is for a family or for a community, someone who sings the story of that people back to them, and sings of their accomplishments, and sings of their ancestors, and sings of all of the things that give them nobility and power and identity, and will not only sing of the history, but will sing of the current people and of the context, and connects people not only to their ancestors, but to future generations in song.
Right.
And it's very healing and empowering. And they even have competitions among griots, right? For people, this is where the sort of rap battle kind of thing began, when people would sort of compete in these extemporaneous songs.
Right.
And they were, some would be attached to a particular family or a clan, and some were traveling. And mm-hmm. I'm just interested in you and the work you do as in through that lens, and how you see yourself as a griot.
I definitely see myself as a storyteller.
Mm-hmm.
But more so than as a story carrier.
Oh.
You know, and I use that reference with all respect for mm-hmm. the history of it mm-hmm. and the intention of it. So I feel like I can embrace that, but with acknowledgement of the ancestral, you know, meaning of that.
Yeah.
And even when working with you, I have written a poem where I tell them that they are urban griots.
Yeah.
So, and then explaining to them what that means. And so they hold it in higher reverence.
And then you see them kind of their chest puffs out, and they,
yes.
Wow, I'm doing that. Yeah.
Right, right.
Yeah.
They are storytellers of their generation, and we need that. We need them to embrace that, and then to go out and then teach others how to be storytellers. So, you know, when I talk about creative revolutionists, it's mostly because I'm trying to create revolution within people, to take their creativity and then create revolution within other people. And it's hard for me to be put into a box. Mm. I can't just be an artist. I can't just be a writer. I can't just be, you know, a singer.
Right.
You know, I have to be all of these things and use it to, you know, really revolutionize people's ability to express their own art. And so, you know, my deepest desire is to use my creative gifts to help people let go and gather up and then move on in order to find their voice and their place in the world. Mm. You know, that's really what my mantra is. And so being a revolutionist, that's what that requires. You know, in order to create change, you have to, you have to revolutionize.
You have to agitate a little
you
bit.
You have to agitate.
Yeah.
You know, you have to push people's buttons a little bit.
Nothing, the poet Rumi said that the soil must be tilled before anything new can grow in it.
Absolutely.
You have to break it up a
yes.
little bit. Wow. Well, S. Renee Mitchell, thank you so much for being
Thanks
here. This has been
me.
A great episode. Folks, if you've been encouraged by what you heard here today, I would hope you would do two things. I would hope you would get to the three websites that were mentioned and check out Renee's work and get that credit card out and purchase some of the stuff and support some of these youth artists and also Renee's work. And then the other thing I hope you would do was be inspired to make your own art, to step into your own community with courage, and boldness, and with the desire to make connections, to see social justice, and to see the world transform through art into the world we want, and into the world where people have opportunity to express themselves and find the voice that is within each and every one of us.
Right.
We very much appreciate you being
Thank
with
you.
The program.
Keep raising hope.
Davis Slater, special shout out to you, because he was on and on about how much we had to have you on the show. So
I love Davis.
I'm sure he'll be happy that this worked out. And folks, we are On the Block Radio. This is your host, Andy Gervich. This has been a great episode. I hope you've enjoyed it, and we will see you down the road.
You've been listening to On the Block with Andrew Gervich. The show is produced in Portland, Oregon by Michael DiNapoli at MD Productions. Theme music by Cat Power. Closing music by Jonathan Oak. Look us up on the web at ontheblockradio.com, where you can also link to us on Facebook, Instagram, and Twitter. Don't forget to tune in next week for a brand new episode. Previous episodes can be found on our website. Thanks for listening.
Oh, you beautiful kitty kitties. Oh, look at you out there. Creators of art, of history, of thought. New minds looking at this world and our lives. Beautiful, beautiful, like a bolt of light. lightning in your head. It keeps trying to tell you to remember that the world is a paper-thin veil over the truth. We've got our fingers in the seams. We've got our ears against the wall, listening, waiting for the voice of creation to speak our names, to call us back from the brink. It's 11:59 and counting. It's apocalypse, children. Apocalypse.
An ending that led to the beginning of my awakening, so that is where I will start, at the point where I quit my job to follow my heart. 2008 was the year I was at the top of my game, number one newspaper columnist in 5 western states. Shoot, everybody knew my name. And lest you regard that as empty boasting, let me be precise. I was nominated for the prestigious Pulitzer Prize twice. But in a moment of impulse, I walked away from the only career I had ever known. After 25 years, I was an expert at cherry-picking the words of others, sauteing them with my own, and serving up such a spicy banquet of salacious sentences you wouldn't even have room in your belly for dessert. Yet, my storyline fit the moral of the fiction you told yourself about who you thought I was. See, you forced me to learn how to make my smiles the biggest outlaws that ever existed. You were always searching for evidence of them at their last known address. So I'd grin, with eyes so blank you could fill out every line and cash that happiness check without the bank ever realizing it was forged joy. Year after year, I tried my best to remember the right steps to that dance with deception. Keep your weight on the balls of your feet. Extend right arm up. Keep it tense. Pay attention. Follow his lead. Stand with your feet close together. Step backward with your right foot, then your left. Bring your right foot next to your left foot. You are back where you started. Now repeat. It may sound easy, but it was no small feat to take a back seat to your own life. But in public, I was the good journalist, the good mother, the good wife. You saw me, but you didn't know me. I was all show, so you couldn't tell. I was so despondent, I wanted to crawl out of my own skin, shed my pain within like a courageous caterpillar, metamorphosing into something beautiful, something other. For so long, my heart was torn and bleeding from brutal, haunting words and pointless attempts to make you remember I was the one in the white dress you promised to love and cherish forever. Well, at least until you died, or maybe until I died. And at that moment, I thought those were appropriate words to a song, yet in real life, you were intent on moving that process along. So, in a moment of lucidity, or rather, what you called inherent stupidity, our marriage became liquidity. I cashed in my dreams for my freedom. I quit you. I was done. And eventually, I quit my job too. People thought I was crazy for following my heart. Heart don't pay the rent, they warned. But a heart, I learned, can restore passion to a deflated soul so weary and wounded she was blinded to her own possibilities. I believe a heart can hold my hand and rub my back gently and say, look again, one more time, look again. Until the day I can stand before a mirror alone and like what I see looking back. That is what art has done for me. It saved my life. People always want to talk about social justice, about fighting for issues bigger than themselves, and that is certainly a necessary gesture, a noble cause, to use art to call attention to poverty, violence, and wars. But I say, to live life authentically, you first have to know how to be your own cause. Honestly, how can you save a life when you're drowning in misery and can't even breathe? Go find your misplaced heartbeat. Understand that the people who gave you advice dressed in wolves' clothing, you can't, you shouldn't, you couldn't, you aren't, and you never will be. They lied to you. So forgive yourself. You believed loved ones always spoke the truth. You didn't know. Be diligent in the search for the right expression of your own reality. Look between the cracks of life's cement and celebrate your weeds for having the audacity to reach for sunlight. Acknowledge your indiscretions and treat them like you're on a scavenger hunt for wisdom. Disappointments are there to remind you that hope is alive and longing to be the refrain of your life's anthem. Be an authentic artist. But it is not an easy journey. You cannot be on this divine path and still live your life based on others' expectations. Sometimes social justice is wrapped up in the righteous anger of one who is done with what is and ready to embrace what will come. Righteous anger might be exactly what you need to step away from the seductive shadows of dark night and to know that you are unquestionably worthy of saving your own life. We are here, searching for answers just like you, and we are more than willing to help you carry your load that has your back bowed down so far you can kiss your own toes. Together, let us lean into the uncertainty, sit with the unanswered questions, and keep them company like you're entertaining long-lost relatives who just won the lottery. So write, paint, sing, draw, dance, collect and reuse, create wonder. Find your voice in whatever language your imagination speaks best. The creativity within you was always meant to be expressed, and even when it feels like no one is listening, speak louder and let her be born. Let her be born with intention and handled tenderly, gratefully. Let her emerge from the depths where shameful secrets have burrowed so deeply into your bosom you almost forget they even exist. Let her speak to me through you so that I may reclaim myself and know that I am finally understood. Let her be born. She is waiting for your invitation, a spiritual summons that can only travail when you embrace the love, the tragedies, the emotional depth that makes us human. She is a mosaic thread connecting us all in ways we cannot even comprehend. She is the completion of your H-E-A-R-T. She is art. She is art. She is art. Let her be born. I quit my job to follow my heart. And this amazing, life-giving organ took me on a remarkable and creative journey that led me back to myself.